Hello students, welcome to EPJ Parshala. Today we will start with module number 8, plume behavior. So let's start. In meteorology, we study about the movement of air mass from one place to the other. Many times, the particle in the air parcel get transported vertically by a process called turbulent diffusion or eddy diffusion. This horizontal and vertical motion of air parcel is responsible for various atmospheric processes such as cloud formation and plume behavior. In this module, we shall study the concept of atmospheric stability and lapse rate, the type of stability, plume behavior of pollutants released from stack and air quality models. The model shall, however, be limited to point source Gaussian dispersion model and its application to linear and area source models. So let's start with atmospheric stability. The resistance of the atmosphere to vertical motion is called as atmospheric stability. An air parcel in meteorology refers to an air mass having more or less uniform properties. An air parcel will expand and cool as it rises and will compress and warm as it sinks. The reason behind this primarily is that as the air parcel rises, it encounters lower pressure and vice versa. If we assume that the process is adiabatic, which implies that no exchange of energy of air parcel occurs with the environment, then as the air parcel rises, it will expand and cool since the internal energy is used up during the process. The term adiabatic is derived from Greek word impassible, implying a system which does not lose or gain any energy. Reverse process occurs when the air parcel sinks and internal energy is released during sinking, which warms up the air parcel. So next, coming to lapse rate, it refers to the rate of change of temperature or pressure with height. In the atmosphere, this rate of change of temperature with altitude is called as environmental lapse rate, also known as ELR, and corresponds to 6.5 degrees Celsius per kilometer. This implies that for every kilometer increase in altitude, temperature drops by 6.5 degrees Celsius. Actual vertical temperature gradient in the atmosphere are thus highly variable and can even show an increase in temperature with height, a situation known as temperature inversion. If a dry parcel of air is considered instead of environment, a linear relationship exists between temperature and altitude for rising or sinking of the air parcel, which is known as dry adiabatic lapse rate, also known as DALR, and is equals to 9.8 degrees Celsius per kilometer. When condensation of or evaporation occurs in the air, however, lapse rate of rising or falling air differ from DALR values due to effect of latent heat. Latent heat is released by condensation and consumed by evaporation of water. This leads to change in adiabatic lapse rate since energy released by condensation compensates the rate of cooling of rising air. This modified lapse rate is termed as saturated adiabatic lapse rate, known as SALR, or moist adiabatic lapse rate, known as MALR. Since the concentration of water vapor in air varies from place to place, SALR is nonlinear in nature. The average value of SALR in the troposphere is generally 6 degrees Celsius per kilometer. Now let's see how many kind of stabilities are there which exist in our atmosphere. Stability of atmosphere is affected by some factors, which includes temperature of surrounding environment and temperature of the parcel of air. Accordingly, the types of stabilities are as follows. First one is stable atmosphere. If the air parcel is displaced vertically and it returns back to its original position, the atmosphere is said to be stable. It usually occurs when the ELR, that is environmental lapse rate, is less than adiabatic lapse rate, which is ALR, a phenomenon occurring generally during temperature inversion. If such a parcel of air is uplifted, it will cool to lower temperature than its new surrounding along the ALR, thus becoming denser than the surroundings. Hence, the air parcel will tend to fall back to its original level. Second one is neutrally stable atmosphere. If the parcel of air is displaced vertically, it will acquire a new position and continue to remain in its position. This generally occurs when the environmental lapse rate is more or less equal to ALR, adiabatic lapse rate. Next one is unstable atmosphere. If the parcel of air is displaced vertically, it will accelerate away from its original position in the direction of the initial displacement. Such unstable condition occurs when environmental lapse rate is greater than adiabatic lapse rate. Plume behavior refers to the dispersal pattern of gaseous pollutants in atmosphere, depending upon wind condition, atmospheric stability, vertical temperature profile. It shows seasonal as well as diurnal variations. Accordingly, there are various type of plume represented diagrammatically in figure number 1. So the first one is looping plume. It takes place when the atmosphere is very unstable. Wind speed is greater than 10 meter per second, has super diabetic lapse rate and is accompanied with solar heating. It follows a wave-like pattern and provide high degree of mixing at lower levels, sometimes reaching ground. Next one is fumigation plume. It occurs when plume reaches the ground level along the length of plume and is caused by a super adiabatic rate beneath an inversion. This super adiabatic lapse rate at the ground level occurs due to solar heating and is quite undesirable since the pollutants remain at ground level. This condition is favored by clear sky and light winds. Third one is coning plume. It results when the vertical air temperature gradient occur between dry adiabatic and isothermal, the air being slightly unstable with some horizontal and vertical mixing occurring. Coning is the most likely occur during cloudy or windy periods. The fourth one is fanning plume. They spread out horizontally but do not mix vertically. Fanning plumes takes place when inversion condition exists in atmosphere. That is, the air temperature increases with altitude. The plume rarely reaches the ground level unless the inversion is broken by surface heating or topographical barriers such as hill. At night, with light winds and clear skies, fanning plumes are quite common. The fifth one is lofting plume. It diffuses upward but not downward and occurs when there is super adiabatic layer above a surface inversion. A lofting plume will generally not reach the ground surface, so there is less pollution at ground level. The last one is trapping. This is a condition accompanied by weak lapse below inversion aloft. So let's move on to type of air quality models. Start with Gaussian, used for estimating the ground level impact of non-reactive pollutants from stationary sources in a smooth terrain. Second one is numerical, which is used for estimating the impact of reactive and non-reactive pollutants in complex terrain. Third one is statistical model, which is employed in situation where physical or chemical processes are not well understood. The last one is physical, which involves experimental investigation of source impact in a wind tunnel facility. So let's start with the example of air quality models. So let's start with the dispersion model. These models estimate the concentration of pollutants at specified ground level receptor in the vicinity of emission sources. These air quality models are used to determine compliances with National Ambient Air Quality Standards, which is known as NAAQS, and the other regulatory requirement such as New Source Review, known as NSR, and Prevention of Significant Deterioration, known as PST regulation. The other one is photochemical models. These models estimate pollutant concentration and deposition of both inert and chemically reactive pollutants such as ozone particulate matter, known as PM, and mercury over large spatial scale and are used in regulatory assessments. Third one is receptor model. These models use chemical and physical characteristic of gases and particles measured at source and receptor to identify and quantify contribution of atmospheric sources to receptor. Now, the point source Gaussian dispersion model, which is one of the widely accepted model to measure the concentration of pollutant emitting from a point source, to help answer the question given below, such as how do pollutants behave in the atmosphere once they have been emitted, how may we predict their concentration in the atmosphere, how can we predict the improvement in air quality that must be achieved when new sources are proposed, we use computer models. These models use the following input, which includes predicted emissions, smokestack heights, wind data, atmospheric temperature profiles, ambient temperature, solar insolation, local terrain features. So the point source Gaussian plume model is based on the assumption that the time average pollutant concentration downwind from a source can be modeled using normal or Gaussian dispersion distribution curve. The basic Gaussian dispersion model applies to single point source known as smokestack, line sources such as emission from motor vehicles along a highway or emission from railways area. Area sources, these can be modeled as large number of point sources. Consider a single point source, for example, a smokestack. The coordinate system shows a cross section of plume with Z representing vertical direction and X is the distance directly downwind from the sources. If we were to observe the plume at any particular instant, it might have some irregular shape, such as outline of looping plume shown. A few minutes later, however, the plume might have an entirely different boundary. Thus, this time average plume envelope develop over a period of time. Since stack emissions have some initial upward velocity and buoyancy, it might be some distance downwind before the plume envelope might begin to look symmetrical about a center line. The center line is generally somewhat above the actual stack height. The highest concentration of pollution would be along the center line with decreasing concentrations as the distance from this center line increases. The Gaussian plume model assumes that the pollutant concentration follows a normal distribution about this center line in both horizontal and vertical directions. It also treats emission as they came from a virtual point source along the plume center line at an effective stack height h. Gaussian point source dispersion equation relates average steady state pollutant concentration to source strength, wind speed, effective stack height and atmospheric conditions. It forms can be derived from the basic considerations involving gaseous diffusion in three-dimensional space. The following assumptions are incorporated into the analysis of concentration of pollutants using Gaussian plume model. The rate of emission from the source is constant. The wind speed is constant both in time and with the elevation. Third one is the pollutant is conservative in nature such that it is not lost by decay, chemical reaction or deposition. Fourth one is on hitting the ground, all is reflected and none is absorbed. The terrain is relatively flat, open country. The three-dimensional coordinate system has a stack at the origin with distance directly downwind given by x. Distance off the downwind axis specified by y and elevation given by z. Since our concern is people and ecosystem at ground level, the following Gaussian plume equation applies only when z is equals to 0. As you can see in equation number 1, where C is the concentration at ground level at the point given in microgram per meter cube, Y is the horizontal distance from the plume center line in meter, Q is the emission rate of pollutants in microgram per second, and H is the effective stack height in meter. The effective stack height includes the height of the stack plus the plume rise. UH is the average wind speed at effective height of the stack in meter per second. SY is the horizontal dispersion coefficient in meter and SZ is the vertical dispersion coefficient in meter. From equation 1, the following points are clear. Ground level pollution concentration is directly proportional to the source strength, which is known as Q, so that the amount of source reduction required to achieve a desired decrease in downwind concentration can be determined. Ground level pollution decreases when taller stacks are used, although relationship is not linear. There is no explicit relationship between the emission rate Q and the downwind distance X. Downwind concentration appears to be inversely proportional to the wind speed and is slightly modified by the dependence of plume rise, delta H, on wind speed. The Gaussian plume equation is based on both theory and actual measure data, and its prediction is accurate to plus minus 50%. However, it is still very useful due to its universal acceptance, easy to use, and allows comparison between estimates made by different modelers in varying situations. So let's move to line source dispersion model. In some circumstances, it is appropriate to model sources distributed along a line as if they formed a continuously emitting infinite line source. Examples of same include motor vehicle traveling along a straight section of highway, agricultural burning along the edge of a field, or a line of industrial sources on the bank of a river. Under conditions of an infinite length source at ground level, with wind blowing perpendicular to the line, the ground level concentration of pollutant at perpendicular distance x from the line source can be described by the following equation, which is equation number 2, where Q is equals to emission rate per unit of distance along the line given in per gram per second. Let's move to the area source dispersion model. For distributed sources, various technology and methodology can be applied to estimate pollutant concentration. If there are modest number of point sources, it is reasonable to use the point source Gaussian plume equation for each sources to predict its individual contribution. Then by superposition, find the total concentration at a given location by summing the individual contribution. So another approach could be multiple use of Gaussian line source equation by dividing an area into a series of parallel strips and then treating each strip as a line source. The total concentration on any strip can be estimated. Another approach involves estimating pollutant concentration over an area such as a city by using the box model concept. Consider the airshed over an urban area to be represented by a rectangular box with base dimension L and W and height H. The box is oriented such that wind speed is U is normal to one side of the box. The height of the box is determined by mixing depth and emission per unit area will be represented by QS. Consider the air blowing into the box on the upwind side to have pollutant concentration C in, and assume that no pollutant is lost from the box along the sides parallel to the wind or from the top. It is assumed that the pollutants are rapidly and completely mixed in the box, creating a uniform average concentration known as C. Also, the pollutants are assumed to be conservative in nature such that they do not react, decay or fall out of airstream. Thus, the amount of pollutant in the box is the volume of box times the concentration, can be represented by LWHC. The rate at which air is entering and leaving the box is the area of either N times the wind speed, WHU. So the rate at which pollutants is entering the box is WHU C in. The rate at which it leaves the box is WHU C. If we assume the pollutant is conservative in nature, then the mass balance equation for the box may be written as rate of change of pollution in the box, which is equal to rate of pollution entering the box minus rate of pollution leaving the box, as you can see in equation number 3, where C in is the concentration in the incoming air given in milligram per meter cube, QS is the emission rate per unit area, milligram meter square per second, H is the mixing height given in meter, L is the length of air shed in meter, W is the width of air shed in meter, U is the average wind speed against one edge of the box in meter per second. The steady state solution to equation number 3 can be obtained by setting dc by dt is equals to 0, so that equation number 4. Equation number 3 can also be solved to obtain the time dependent increase in pollution above the city, letting C 0 be the original concentration in the air shed above the city at the time t is equals to 0. The solution becomes the equation number 5. If it is assumed that the incoming wind blow no pollution into the box and if the initial concentration in the box is 0, then equation number 5 becomes equation number 6. When t is equals to L by U, the exponential function becomes E1 and the concentration reaches about 63% of its final value. This is called time constant, the ventilation time, the residence time or the E folding time. Gaussian model includes some advantages and limitations. So let's start with the advantages. First advantage is that it's easy to calculate. The other one is the fast response time of the model. Third one is that it can be applied to real-time GIS-based decision support software. It can be successfully used for a wide range of studies of air quality in urban and industrial areas. Coming to limitations, which includes that it does not incorporate meteorological parameters and unsatisfactory performance in industrial incidences such as Bhopal or Chernobyl disaster. Example of advanced Gaussian model includes American Meteorological Society or Environmental Protection Agency regulatory model known as AIRMOD. It is an open source Gaussian air dispersion model developed by US Environmental Protection Agency known as EPA to carry out impact studies of planned or existing industrial sites. It has built-in model to handle complex terrain and urban boundary layer. Besides, although AirMod uses the steady state approximation for the flow and the source, it can be used within 10 to 100 kilometers distance using its meteorological preprocessor known as AirMet. The other one is complex terrain dispersion model known as CTDM. This has also been developed by EPA to estimate concentration patterns in mountain region. Atmospheric dispersion modeling system known as ADMS. The ADMS model has been developed in Europe for air quality simulations. It incorporates meteorological effects like coastal circulations, complex terrain, deposition processes, and radioactive decay. The Cambridge Environmental Research Consultants, which is known as CERC, United Kingdom Meteorological Office and Cambridge Environmental Research Consultants, known as CERC, also developed by the ADMS urban module that aims to provide air quality forecast for cities. Other Gaussian models include Kaline 3, which is used for highway air pollution, the offshore and coastal dispersion model known as OCD for coastal areas. The third one is Buoyant Line Point Source Model known as BLP and the Industrial Source Complex known as ISC. These models are used for industrial sites. Aerial Location of Hazardous Atmosphere known as ALOHA for accidental and heavy gas releases. They are widely used by authorities, environmental protection organization, and industrial investigations. At the end of this module, the reader shall be able to understand the types of atmospheric stability, how it affects the plume behavior, type and example of air quality model with special reference to point source Gaussian dispersion model. These models find wide application in the management of air quality as well as predicting future scenarios of air quality. This is relevant due to rising air pollution level all over the globe and provide a fast, simplistic and cost-effective solution at local level, especially at site where air quality monitoring is difficult due to experimental difficulties. Thank you very much.